reflection of the individualism in current philosophies that the phrase care of the soul is sometimes taken to mean work in one's individual psyche or personality. Older philosophies recognize that the soul has individual, social, and cosmic dimensions. And so you can speak of a person's soul, a nation's soul, and the soul of the world. To care for the soul, we can't stop at the borders of our own lives. We must engage somehow with the people around us in the natural world that is neither inanimate nor without personality. It's incorrect to speak of the human being as a social animal. We are social souls and can find our individuality only in community, a community only where we have the opportunity to be full individuals. Even the person who by fate and taste lives a rather secluded life may be engaged with nature like Dickinson in her garden, or with political world like Ficino in his many letters to political leaders. In his letters to Bernard Bambo and Lorenzo Il Magnifico, Ficino spells out the requirements for a convivial life, a life quickened by the pleasure of living with common will and purpose. It's easy to forget that ultimately we find our personal goals fulfilled when the common good is kept in mind. Political parties can thrive only when they preserve the dialectic between their own personal precious values and the welfare of the community at large. Religious people sometimes forget that community is not the same as a homogeneity of belief. You may not realize that the religion is only served only when they pursue their vision and conviction in a setting where they're not only tolerate but support and appreciate alternative points of view. As individuals too, we may become so absorbed in our own efforts if we fail to give attention to the various communities in which we live. The soul is most present on the border between individual and the communal. In this context, economies ideally address the needs of the community and the individual. We have to keep in mind expansive opportunity for private enterprise and responsiveness to the individual within the community. A community that more and more must be defined globally. To live convivially means not merely distributing resources and opportunities, but more than that, taking pleasure in the other success and well-beings. Ficino's word may sound out the steps of the pragmatic and cynicism of our time, but he presents a tough challenge to give up the narcissistic pursuit of personal success and take up a vision that is essentially communal, based on a profound appreciation of the other as a piece in the creation of a soul-filled life. History has demonstrated how difficult it is to tend both one's own agenda and the other's well-being. The stories of our past show only fleeting moments of the sweet communion of life. The work is so difficult that it is tempting to find enemies everywhere we look, especially in our own community. We often approach our goals with a false innocence, pretending that our national interests or religious convictions offer exclusive criteria for the morality of our behavior. An important element in the nurturing of the common life is an honest and courageous confrontation with our own evil inclinations and behavior. Often we fail in the attempt to serve the common life, and so the emotions and attendant rituals of remorse and atonement are essential for sustaining the soul in everyday life. To confess our failure and offer compensation even for our collective injustices transforms misdeed into a social initiation where we find our sensitivities deepened. Moral pollution weakens society, but if people can restore itself through visible, tangible, honest reflection and repentance. The religions of the world write in their teaching of the importance of such rituals only in a society that has forgotten the religious and spiritual roots of community could pollute itself with remorse. We can also come to terms with our own capacity for evil by deepening our innocence. True innocence is an achievement that comes through a thorough acknowledgement of our own moral shadow. By taking neither the moral high ground nor the low ground, but struggling with the lifelong attempt to even deepen our ethical vision and responses. In our lifetime, individualism has been so strong in our philosophy that we may need to have an occasion to consider radically the notion of a truly communal life. It wouldn't take much to conceive a business or enterprise in service of families and communities. It wouldn't take much imagination to connect work with individual calling and orient it towards the real needs of a community. Then we might discover to our surprise that money, business, commerce, and industry can be part of our work of the soul.